and I don't know, it bricked it initially. I had to go in and get a hacker tools that is used for jailbreaking and manually rewrite my ROM to the firmware so I could re-put the iOS 9 on it again. After it bricked it, I decided to make a second pass. It worked the second time. It actually ended up being Concordia's network.
Well, that's kind of the evidence.
Well, yeah, somewhere in the middle of the process is a... it must dial in to confirm that you're allowed to run the beta, but they don't make it. They don't make it obvious that it's connecting to the internet and doing that. It just sat there and did nothing. So I'm thinking it stalled out, right? So I manually stop it.
Bad idea.
Totally don't do that. Okay, do not manually stop it mid OS install. Because I couldn't even get back to the connect to iTunes thing.
That's really impressive.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
No, it was.
Oh, that's impressive.
Yeah.
That's legitimately impressive.
We got back, so now I have 9.1 on here, and nothing works. Good. But the good news is apps launch first and act like they're going to launch, and then crash. So it's a.
I wonder how my phone
is. It's a step up.
Yes. They stab you in the front. all right. So in any case, once we get iOS, Xcode 7.0, which has officially dropped now, by the way. So if you have Macs, you can go ahead and update to it. We'll start doing this Apple Watch stuff. So here's an example of some of the stuff we'll be working on here with the emulator. But today we're going to work on your go through your homework assignment. There is an assignment already up for due on Friday. This one is a short paper. As we start transitioning to actually doing iOS stuff, one of the things we want to look at is something called the MVC Model View Controller design pattern. And what I have you look at in this paper is to compare and contrast the Model View Controller implementation for iOS versus Android to understand the mobile application approach. After we go through the homework today, we'll start talking about the Model View Controller a little bit and start angling on the iOS side. So I'm really asking you to research whatever we don't cover today and then the Android's version of that. Okay? So let's go ahead and let's open recent playground. All right, so you say this thing has an output on the bottom now?
Yeah, if you see the little arrow all the way at the bottom, on the bottom left, yeah, hit that. And then any of your outputs it'll actually put down there.
Oh, okay. Remember last class I told you that println's actually going away?
Yeah.
Oh, that's dirty.
Yeah.
So it's just print now.
All right. So in any case.
If you go up actually and go to, where is it?
What is it? I mean, let's just cook. Unless you have something really interesting.
It was the that auto changeover software.
What fun's that? Where is that? I just want to know where it's at. I'm not going to click it. I promise.
I got to remember where it's at.
All right. So, homework was to create a class fraction. Yeah. All right. I wonder how you make this bigger down here.
Edit, convert, and then to latest Swift syntax.
September 16th, 14, 16, 43, my playground, 38,523, error, CG context, save G state, invalid context.
All right, let's see, can I change my font down there? Just wonder what this guy is. No, it doesn't matter. We'll figure it out later. Or one of you can figure it out and tell it to me. We're going to be moving away from this pretty soon anyways.
Yeah, if you went over that ad, though, it's under edit and then convert, and then it'll say to latest Swift syntax.
Okay.
Interesting. It worked. It seems to work.
All right. So we're supposed to create a fraction class, right? So we're going to have a fraction, our class fraction. And our class fraction is going to keep track of two fields, correct? We're going to have a numerator and denominator. So we'll have a var numerator, and this guy's going to be an int. And we'll have a var denominator, and this guy's going to be an int. And then we need a constructor for creating our fraction class. So constructors in Swift are always named init, right? So we have init, and this guy is going to take in a numerator of type int, and a denominator of type int. And we're going to set self.numerator equal to numerator, and self.denominator equal to denominator. All right, then we're supposed to have a display method. Let's just kind of go easy street initially. We'll just build a fraction, display a fraction, proving that our little mechanics here are working. So we're going to create a function that returns nothing. So functions start with the word func, and we'll name this guy display. Display will take in no parameters, and just for practice, go ahead and say it'll return a void, even though I think Nick told us that's not required.
Correct.
Okay.
There is a built-in display function. So I named mine something different just so it didn't get confused.
Well, it should just override it. Okay. We'll see here in a second if that's the case. Missed a quiz.
Okay.
No, I'm just kidding. You didn't.
Okay.
Really? You wouldn't have cared?
No.
Why?
Because I know my assignments are good.
I love that statement. Did you say that based on a story I told you one time? Or you don't even. Oh my gosh, that totally happened in grad school. I was in a computer architecture 2 course, like the second level of our hard architecture course, and it was like the course nobody liked to take. So it was me and like, I don't know, 6 other Indian or Pakistani students or something like that. After undergrad, computer science graduate and PhD programs tend to be primarily non-American. It's kind of a thing. But in any case, there was these 2 girls that sat in front of me. We got our homework assignment back, and I got like an 8 out of 10 on it. This teacher was, his name's Dr. DeVolder. He's the chair at the school now. And in any case, he would give these really hard assignments. And it was, you could spend 45 minutes on it and get an 80. Or you could spend 4 days on it and get a 95 or 100. So I spent 45 minutes on it, right? So I was like, well, why didn't you do this? Why didn't you do this? Because they would spend like hours and hours and hours working on this thing together. And the teacher's standing right there, and I say something like, I know I'm going to get an A in the exams, and the exams are worth 40% of your grade each. So 80% of your grade in that class was midterm and final, 40% apiece. So I don't need anything better than an 80 on the – it was pretty funny. So that was reminded me of that. So even if we had a quiz, I would have given you an A on it. For that statement.
So the teacher was by you when you saw that?
Huh? He was standing 2 feet from me. No, he laughed. It was true. Yeah, it was, lowest grade I got an exam in there, I think, was like a 98. I think he misgraded that.
Well done.
Same thing happened when I was working on my PhD for operating systems class. The professor, his name was Dr. Simcoe. Everybody hated this guy. Everybody tried to dodge his class. He was a bodybuilder, so he'd come into class, he'd like flex and stuff during class. It was really funny. But the problem was apparently he had lots of friends in the department, so he would make it onto a lot of people's dissertation committees. And he wouldn't sign off on anybody's dissertation if you dodged his class. It's kind of the storyline there. I actually really like the guy. In fact, I model a lot of my classes actually off of him. well, no, and here's the reason. I'm not a fan of like exams and stuff that are just memorization-based. I like students to show true competence rather than their ability to just memorize something. So his exams, which everybody was afraid of, were hard for them because they thought, oh, well, if I could just go and memorize all these operating systems terms, I'm fine. As opposed to he would ask you questions that asked you to apply what you understood about operating systems. So everybody's like, because for a PhD, you have these things called qualifying exams, where it's like an exam that's covering like the entire, like the dinosaur book, for example, and you either pass it or they kick you out of the program. And you get usually 2 shots. So I go in, and we take this, it's like a 4-hour exam. I take this exam, hand in, and I was always kind of a jerk, I guess. I've mellowed quite a bit in terms of cockiness, but I walk in and says, you could just use this as your answer key. So I got a 94 on that one. I think he misgraded that too. Second highest grade was a 32 in the class. So that was actually funny. So then so everybody else failed it. They got one more chance to pass it. One guy, I think, passed the second time. So there was this giant lawsuit. All these students, because this was like their last class. So these students, you know, they're $100,000 into a PhD and get kicked out of the program. It's awesome. And the funnier part about it, you can ask those of you who know my wife and stuff, you can ask her. I unwrapped the book the night before this exam. It still had plastic on it.
Should have videotaped it for after the exam.
She still uses it as an example if there's something wrong with me. So anyways, a totally extra credit. In fact, the next time you miss points on a quiz, I'll just pretend like you didn't. So I totally love that attitude. Oh, I had him in senior sem.
Okay, did you hear how long it took him?
To do the project?
Yeah.
Oh, you're talking about the volleyball iPhone app thing.
He finished half of it, right? Yeah. He only finished half of it. It took him a week. He did it the last week of school.
Doesn't surprise me. He's bright.
Nothing. And I'm pretty sure he didn't even start until like midnight every single night.
Yeah, nothing wrong with that.
We tried day.
Yeah. All right, so we're going to have a function called display. It's going to return nothing. This isn't required, but I like being explicit generally when I program. So you're going to get used to using the syntax if you specify that I'm not going to return anything. So I'd encourage you to do that for now. Okay, so what we're going to do here is we're going to print out maybe our numerator followed by a slash followed by our denominator, something like that. So we have a print now with no println, correct? Mm-hmm. So I'll put an open and closing parenthesis in here, and we'll go ahead and put our slash in the middle. Then we'll do backslash open parenthesis, backslash open close parenthesis, self.numerator, self.denominator. And then does it automatically kick it down a line, or do I, let's just find out, that, or I'll put a carriage return in there. So I've created my class. It doesn't do much. It has a constructor, keeps track of two fields, numerator and denominator, and then has the ability to display itself. So let's go ahead and create a couple of fractions. Let's say var f1 is equal to fraction numerator is 1, denominator is 2. And then we'll say var f2 is equal to fraction numerator is 3, denominator is 6. That way we have something to reduce here in a few minutes. And then we'll say f1.display and f2.display. Okay. Oh, it looks like it kicks it down a line automatically. So we have 1/2 and 3/6. Is that big enough? Can you read it-ish? If you can't, it doesn't matter because I don't know how to make the font bigger. Exercise for the reader. All right, questions about that? Okay, so what else are we supposed to do? We're supposed to be able to add fractions to each other, resulting in a new fraction. So let's write that function. So again, it's another function, func. It'll be called add. This guy is going to take in a let's call this guy I want to call it fraction, lowercase. Well, good enough. So he's going to take a fraction in as a parameter, and he'll add himself to the fraction that was passed in. All right. Now, how do we add fractions? Well, we need to come up with a common denominator. So in order to get a common denominator, the easy way is to do cross multiplication. Multiplication, right? Okay, so we're going to multiply our denominators together, giving us our new beast mode denominator, right? So let's create a var new denom, and this guy will be equal to self.denominator times fraction. I knew that was going to burn. Fraction.denominator. He's going to want to keep making the capital one. Whatever. All right, so that's our new denominator. What are you complaining about? It's complaining that I haven't used that variable yet. It's fine. Okay, just relax for right now. Everything's going to be fine. All right, so let's go ahead and get our new numerator one. Yeah, let's call it that. New num one. Go away. Go back to your home. There we go. New num one is equal to self.numerator times fraction.denominator. Var new num 2 is equal to self.denominator times fraction.numerator. Okay, and then we're ultimately, oh, we didn't do this yet. So we're going to return a fraction from this guy. We're going to be building a brand new fraction.
Can't use vars.
Well, let's relax for a second. We'll fix it up. I'm a language specialist. Everything's going to be fine. All right, so far, so good. This is okay. Then we're going to say, so we have our two new numerators. We have our new denominator. So we're going to go ahead and we're going to return a fraction created with a numerator. And the numerator is going to be new num 1 plus new num 2. And the denominator is going to be new denom. Okay.
I did this a really dumb way.
So let's see. What's this guy screaming at now? Same thing?
Shouldn't you be using self?
Yeah, you have to replace him with let.
Shouldn't I be using self what? Here? New num?
Self.denom equals self.denom times fraction would work.
What?
At the top. The line. Yeah, var new denom. You can change var new denom to self.denom.
You could, but I don't actually want to modify this denominator. I want to generate a brand new fraction that is the result of adding this fraction to a new fraction. Yeah. Otherwise, you would be permanently changing the denominator of this fraction. All right? So I'm guessing it wants us to just use let's here.
Yep. Something with the new Swift.
All right, so we have to use let's because we're not actually changing the values. They're constants. But how did it know they were going to be constants? Let me do this real quick. So if I say that, and then I say new denom is equal to 4, does it let me use a var then? No, then it's cool with a var. Yeah. So if at a later date you prove that you're going to change the value, then it's cool with you making it a var. But until, so what is it? Guilty until proven innocent?
Yeah.
Okay. So if you never, yeah, let until proven var, I guess it would be. But again, this is a good lesson. So when we advertise the difference between vars and lets, vars are for variables that might change. Lets are how we represent constants, values that are not going to change. All right, so we didn't make a change, so this guy will be a let. Get rid of our new denom, because I am using Xcode 7.0, the final beta, which I assume is probably identical to what you guys will be getting, but whatever. All right, and this will grab a brand new fraction. Make sense? So that's our add, so let's go ahead and test this. So let's say var f3 is equal to F1.add F2. F1.add 4. Oh, come on. You think you're better than me? Oh, I think this is that example I mentioned last time where you don't actually have to say fraction.
Mine, like, wouldn't let me. It kept telling me, no, you should just put, like, F1 or
All right. Well, I guess we're going to figure out when that happens. All right. So then I can say F3.display. And that should give us the sum of, so that's 12 twelfths. 1 half plus 1 half. 12 twelfths. Well, 1 half plus 3 sixths. I guess I should have maybe thought that out a little bit better.
Is it okay if we did the add function to not return a fraction, but to just update this fraction that you are adding to?
Yeah, as long as you showed me that you've kind of drilled classes, I don't necessarily care. All right, I just changed my fraction F2 to have a numerator of 6 and a denominator of 8, so 3/4 essentially. All right, so there I get 6/8 as my sum.
No, you get
20/16. Oh, 20/16, that's right. So 1 half, 6/8 by 2, and 20/16 is the sum. Make sense? All right, so now we need to write a subtract. So subtract is going to be pretty similar to add. So just subtract them from each other, although we do need to be careful. Num1 is the first numerator in the denominator. Okay, yeah, I think this is right. In this case, you need to make sure which numerator is what. So that should be subtract. So if I have 1 half and 1 fourth, and I say F1 dot subtract F2, there's my 2/8, my 1/4, what it'll ultimately be. All right, so that's subtract. And then lastly, reduce. Okay, so a fraction should be able to reduce themselves. So func reduce will take in no parameters and also not return anything. Right, because this guy is going to actually internally change its numerator and denominator to be in reduced form. We're not returning a new fraction from this guy. All right, so reduce. First, we've got to find a greatest common divisor of both our numerator and our denominator. That is the value, the largest value that evenly divides both numerator and denominator. So we need to start off, for hard coding this, there's algorithms for determining greatest common divisor, but the straightforward, let's just get this done version of this would be to figure out what is the smaller of our numerator and denominator, right? That's if you want to be at least a little bit efficient. If you don't care, then you can just go through and pick one of them and just count backwards. So actually, we can just do that. Well, let's practice if statements anyway. So we're going to say var permax is equal to self.numerator. Then we're going to say if self.denominator is less than curmax, then curmax is equal to self.denominator. All right. So the after this little chunk of code, curmax will be equal to the smaller of our two numerator and denominator. That is, it's the current maximum greatest common divisor that we could possibly have. Make sense? The smaller of our two numerator and denominator. Now we need to count down all the way to one. We know we'll be good at one, because one will evenly divide both. Okay, and we're looking for situations where curmax both evenly divides the numerator, the current numerator, and the current denominator. And as soon as we find that, we update denominator, we update the numerator, and we're done. All right, so we're going to create a for loop. So for var I starts off at curmax. Keep going as long as I is greater than 1. once it gets to one, we know we're done and we don't need to make any changes. We can actually do this as an infinite while loop as well, but whatever. And then I minus minus each time. So we'll subtract one from I as we count down from Kermax. Okay. Now, each time through, we're going to ask the question, if self.numerator mod I is equal to 0 and self.denominator mod I is equal to 0. If they're both evenly divisible by I, then we're going to say self.numerator divide equals I. Self.denominator divide equals I. And then we could just break out of our loop, or we can just return, or we can set I equal to negative 1, whatever you want to do to get out of this loop somehow. All right, so I'll just say return. Make sure that Swift is happy with that. Even though this returns nothing, I am in fact returning nothing. That's legal. Okay?
Should the if, the very top, the if self.denominator, should that be greater than Kermax?
No, because I want the smaller of the two.
Oh.
I want to get the smaller of my numerator and denominator. So I'm going to guess that it's my current numerator, and if that actually isn't the smallest, I'll set Kermax to what actually is the smallest. Kermax is the maximum value that possibly could divide both. But realistically, this is actually, from a will-it-work perspective, a waste of time. You could just set Kermax to be one of the numerator and denominator and just go. The worst that happens is, well, worst-case scenario is there's a giant gap between your numerator and denominator, and you're trying to divide a 4, for instance, by 57 million. And then 4 by 56,999,999. So you've potentially wasted some cycles there. So that's what we try to save with this. All right. So in any case, this is going to count down from the current value of Kermax all the way to 1 if we have to go there. But if we get to 1, we're not going to have to divide by anything, right? Eventually, we hopefully will hit some value that will evenly divide both. In that case, we'll go ahead and change this guy's numerator and denominator, and then return, which return makes a function immediately end. Make sense? All right. So I should be able to then say something like, let's just go to F3. We'll say F3.reduce, and then say F3.display. And we should get both of our answers. So there's 2/8 is the unreduced F3, and then there's 1/4, which is the reduced F3. Make sense? Now my guess is that there's probably, let's see, do we have like a math dot? No, do we have it? Maybe it's an int. Self dot numerator dot GCD, maybe just GCD. Thought maybe there was a built-in Swift GCD.
Maybe it's written out the long way previously.
Swift GCD, Grand Central Dispatch. Divisor. GCD, how is it? No. Doesn't look like it's built in. Or if it is, there's a math library or something. But whatever. Unimportant for right now. We can just write it ourselves. All right. So questions about that? So this was that everything for the homework? Okay. All right. So hopefully at this point we've had enough experience with kind of the basic constructs that go into Swift that we kind of know enough to be dangerous, right? So now we want to start applying this, let's call it beginner-ish Swift knowledge towards actually writing applications. And in order to do that, we need to understand kind of the anatomy of an iOS application. So let's start talking about that side of the world now. So, start off by let's talk about MVC. Actually, before we talk about that, let's talk about design patterns. All right, so how many of you have heard the phrase design patterns before? Those of you who are pretty much seniors, there's no possible way you haven't heard me say that phrase before. All right, what's a design pattern? So we've heard of it, at least some of us have, so we're just going to assume that all of us have at this point, because I've said it here in the last couple of minutes. So really, actually, all of you have heard it because I said it earlier this class. So you're all liars. Okay, so what is a design pattern?
Pattern of designs.
Okay.
Sort of the structure of how you want your program to be set up and certain rules and things, folder structure and files that you follow, such as, I don't know what your MVC is, but for the MVVM, you have a view model, essentially you only put the code of certain aspects in it that you need to. So if you have a model, you only put things that directly relate to your UI, and so on and so forth to get to the point.
Okay.
Your view is only UI, your model is more code behind.
Yep, that's basically what MVC is.
Yeah.
All right, so, but the generic answer to a design pattern. So first of all, there's millions of design patterns, all right, because it's really in the eye of the beholder. Generically, we're going to say design patterns are best practices for solving common problems. So really, the definition of what is a common problem is very up in the air, right? What's a common problem for me might be different for a common problem for some guy who writes software for calculating comets or something like that. Like he might come up with the XYZ design pattern that's the best way to artificially speculate how the gravity of the celestial body Vega impacts the trajectory of this comet. And he just names the thing, writes a research paper on it and says, well, obviously this is the design pattern, whatever, just comes up. They always have crazy names, right? For academics, design patterns are like the perfect go-to move for getting a publication. You just pick something that you think people are going to want to solve. You name it something kind of funky and put it out there. And the worst that people say is, oh, I actually have a better way. It's like, oh, okay, well, this was a design pattern, but it's been kind of disproven. Check. Research publication. All right. So in any case, best practices for solving common problems, or we can also say, you know, the best way for solving a common problem. That's what a design pattern is. Common design patterns that we maybe have heard of is something called the singleton design pattern. Okay, singleton design pattern, this deals with how do we allow multiple objects to talk to each other? Well, we have one global object that we throw everything into and they all access it. We have one singleton object. And if we have 100 other objects and they all have access to this one singleton object, we can just throw anything they need to share up in there and now they can all access it. Seems like a pretty good way of sharing things. Kind of like if we all had a truck that we were sharing, we might pick a single drawer in this room, maybe over here, throw the keys in there, and whenever we need access to the truck, we go and check to see if the keys are available. So we're all sharing this one place. That's the singleton design pattern. So it sounds a little theoretical for being something so simple. All right, so singleton's pretty common. Let's see, observer, the observer design pattern. This is, you have multiple objects. Some of them are interested in observing events of other objects. So the observer pattern basically says, objects that are observable must wave their arms whenever they do stuff. Emit an event saying, I just did stuff. That way, other objects that are interested in observing, the observers, don't have to sit there and constantly just staring, waiting for something to happen. All right? They can kind of just chill, and as soon as they kind of hear somebody screaming, they look to see if they're falling down. Okay? That's the observer design pattern. What we're going to be interested in here is something called MVC. All these exist in iPhone anyways. So MVC, this is the Model View Controller. Two L's? Five L's?
Six.
Six. Oh, get some ones in there. Okay, Model View Controller. This has to do with what is the best way to implement a graphical user interface in terms of the visuals and the code. All right, when we have a user interface and we think about we have buttons and things that we can click on in our iOS applications, whether it's on our watch or on our smartphone screen or on an iPad, whatever it is. When we click a button, that's something that's visual, right? But we know that an event occurs related to that, and there has to be code somewhere that handles what happens when we click on that button. Okay? So the Model View Controller deals with what's considered to be the best way to handle that kind of animal. And what it really says is we should split the interface design from the code implementation. That is, have them in two separate files and link them somehow. Make sense? So that's the MVC approach. And MVC isn't something specific to iOS or Android, it's the generic, I have a user interface, I have some code that makes it work. Where do I put that crap? Okay.
This is pretty old.
Probably. Yeah, MVC is probably. They've been probably calling it MVC for 10 years, something like that. The concept has been around for a while. They just started. Somebody decided, let's come up with a name for stuff called design patterns and write research papers to get credit. All right. So how does this work in the iOS ecosystem? Now, the first thing we need to know in here is that iOS transcends all of these different platforms. So for instance, whether we're writing an application for iPhone, for iPad, now for Apple TV, or the Apple Watch, we're using the exact same ecosystem and a lot of the exact same mentality. So anything we learn in here, you can translate directly to writing an Apple TV or an iPhone application. You don't have to learn a brand new technology. It's the same crap. All that's changed is how big our screen is that we're putting stuff on. And maybe what kind of widgets are appropriate for that screen. You know, there might be certain widgets that are available on iPad that are not available on iPhone or Apple Watch and things like that just because of the limitations of the screen size. Okay, so typically, historically what we had is we had things called zip files. This would hold a user interface for a single, I don't want to say the word single, that just say for view controller, for a view controller. All right. So if we had two separate screens in our application, you would have, and we're not even talking about the code yet, just the visual side of it, you would have two separate zip files, one for screen one, one for screen two. And inside that zip file, you will drag and drop your buttons and your labels and calendar things, you know, whatever, just your widgets that go on the screen. So every screen of your application on an iOS application will be represented by a single zip file. Now, let's just kind of draw two of them here, just for the sake of argument. That's evolved now into this thing called storyboarding. So what we've really done now is we've created something called a storyboard. So now we have a single kind of container, a single page, single file that holds all of what used to be in a zip file. So now we have a one-stop shop for all of the individual screens in our application so we can view our entire application in one place. This also gave us the power of linking screens in our application through the user interface rather than having to write as much code to go from screen to screen to screen. So it allowed us to do a much more rapid application development on iPhone than we had before. Android still suffers from this today. If you want to write an Android application that has three screens, you know, you create this idea. This is giving you a little bit of a, you know, insight into what you'll be looking at in your for your paper. You create something called an activity. And then you create an intent for launching that activity. Okay, you know, and then you intend to launch this activity, and an activity is what we call a view controller in on the iPhone side of things or the iOS side of things, and that then gets launched. But you have to do it all programmatically. On the iPhone or the iOS ecosystem, if I have one screen and I have another screen, and when somebody clicks this button, I want it to go to this other screen, you go into the storyboard, you control click on this, drag to this, done. Launch the app, click the button, it works. What happened?
You have no idea how much time it could save me.
Now, but that has side effect, and we'll talk about that later. Okay, because when you are programmatically doing stuff, just as the foreshadowing, you have opportunities to pass values from this screen to another screen. If you're not programmatically launching this second screen, instead you're doing a drag-click thing to launch that screen, you've lost that opportunity to let this guy know about some extra stuff, like maybe what user is currently logged in or what number to show up at the top of the screen, that kind of stuff. Things that you knew about here that this guy really needs to know about. So that's where things like the singleton design pattern might come in. It's also where something called segues come in when we deal with iOS stuff. Not important now, just kind of where we're going. All right, so we have this idea of a storyboard, which holds our collection of all of our view controllers. We no longer reference them as zip files, but this is where it came from, okay? Zip files, typically when in any sort of technology, when we have a file name that has an X in it, what does that tell us about it? So for instance, like Microsoft Word files are .docx. What is that X likely to mean? Yeah, references XML. So XML being a data representation language. So typically, for instance, a .docx file is a data representation for a Word document, using XML as the standard. So a zip file is a representation for something called an interface builder. XML interface builder. What it stood for. More trivia knowledge for us right now, but that's where it came from. Okay? Not super important for being able to write Apple Watch stuff, but interesting for how we got to storyboards. when storyboards were first introduced about 4 years ago, they were introduced kind of like a beta type thing, similar to how Swift was really born, where they kind of put Swift in there and said, oh, here's a new language for you to play with. Don't take it that seriously. Same thing was true with storyboards. You know, early on, most people would continue to write their applications using individual zip files because that's what they were already used to doing. Well, then storyboards started, and I poo-pooed storyboards tons when I first started using them. Okay. Now it's like I don't know how I ever survived without storyboards. And those of you who've done some Android application recognize that to write a 3 or 4 screen application, it just says, you know, screen 1, screen 2, screen 3, screen 4 in Android is probably a 40-minute process of just a lot of copy and pasting, but it's tedious, right? You could do that in an iPhone application in about 40 seconds. It's whatever time it takes to drag 4 view controllers onto the screen, drag 4 labels, one onto each, and then click drag between those. Done. So storyboards are really, really good, FYI. All right, so this is the graphical side of things. All right, so we do all of our visual design inside of our storyboards. So design interfaces inside of our storyboards. The flip side of it is working with our .swift files. So then we have a... So let's just say this guy was a class called VC1. And this guy was a class called VC2. I realize we're just about out of time. All right, so now over here you might have a vc1.swift file. And you might have a second file called vc2.swift file. The vc1 file handles the stuff that goes on with this interface. The vc2 file handles the stuff that goes on with this interface. All right, so we've separated the design of the interfaces from the implementation of what that interface does. That's what MVC means. It's the, you know, the 2,000-foot view of MVC. What's the best way of handling that? All right, questions, comments, concerns, bribes. All right, so we have a paper due on Friday. Hopefully we'll have Xcode 7 on the machines, and I'll give you a short get used to using Xcode to write a little iOS-y type thing on Friday to do over the weekend. Okay? So not a huge logic problem, but more of a get used to the click and drag stuff and that kind of stuff. I'll see everybody on Friday.